well for hosting me here. And I've had the pleasure of having lunch with some of your colleagues, so it's been a great experience for me. So I know some of you, that students in class, received the paper. I apologize in advance. You'll hear some of the same themes, but hopefully it'll bring some clarity. And my hope is that I'll keep the presentation to about 30 minutes to 45, 40 minutes, so we can engage in some dialogue afterward about some of the concepts and ideas that are part and parcel of the paper. So I'll just sort of jump right in here. And this paper is bringing a sort of lens, a more theoretical lens, of forces shaping the city and what the implications are for urban placemaking, and in particular, communities that have been marginalized in the media, but also within, I would argue, the planning profession. In U.S. cities, austerity measures and fiscal retrenchment masks a perpetual state of exception that is characterized by the suspension of laws and regulations, disallocation of the poor from social benefits, and abandonment of neighborhoods deemed as underperforming. However, the government is not the sole actor in choosing which parts of the city gets to thrive or perish, but also includes multiple actors at different scales and spheres of decision-making. City bond raiders, risk consultants, phone apps, and social media sites are some of the harbingers of a free market urbanism that is eclipsing historical governance arrangements. Discursive representations that marginalize communities also create placemats that racialize urban space and reproduce existing power relations. Now, the result is a diminished social life at a time when cities in the U.S. are increasingly diverse but remain racially polarized. Despite these sentiments, or perhaps because of them, new social formations are taking hold with implications for urban placemaking. Neighborhoods often described as the ghetto and the barrio are home to many that contribute to the labor market, but are marginalized by policymakers as they do not generate desired tax revenues and are seen as risky public investments. These places also present a different conception of urban space that does not fit easily into regulatory frameworks and rule-bound management. Some of the manifestations in the built environment include the appropriation of public and private land for a range of purposes that defy land use norms, zoning requirements, and the law. Quotidian practices highlight the significance of spatial appropriations by the marginalized and have been represented as expressions of everyday urbanism. And I know you had Margaret Coffin come here a number of weeks ago, so I won't talk much about this. Others have noted that how new social formations, especially immigrants and refugees, destabilize notions of core and periphery that are fundamentally reshaping cities. Among planning scholars, some have theorized the possibilities for insurgent citizenship and the promotion of insurgent practice that aim to support these new citizenship claims. Collectively, these discourses demonstrate that inhabiting the city is constituted by rights and claims and enables subjectivities to emerge. However, the claiming of urban space by individual actors is one thing, but conflating this agency with political action is yet another. Others caution against an overly romantic or populist embrace of the dispossessed. Despite the poor staking claims to land, shelter, and services, the rise of popular movements can also create new forms of dependency and domination through territorial patronage and intergroup disputes. The contingent nature of placemaking suggests that conflicts abound among individuals and between groups and are ultimately defined as struggles over space and power. Beyond universal claims of insurgent citizenship or the symbolic agency found in everyday urbanism, I would like to suggest the relevancy of place in producing a different image of the city, as places are not only the loci for the distribution of social goods, where decisions at multiple scales acutely affect the everyday lives of people, but also the space where citizens confront these issues in a real, tangible sense. In social terms, places can be viewed as assemblages of different practices that involve negotiations between groups whose histories are intertwined and are situated in territorialized space. Now, this definition of place acknowledges the complex entanglements in which planning and urban design is situated, but allows for a different conceptualization of practice. As a setting for rights claims, place also draws attention to the political and raises important questions. Which rights, for whom, and how entitlements manifest in material terms. In what follows, I'm going to argue that places are sites of world-making, social imaginations of space that are produced as groups claim territory, secure the necessities of life, and negotiate their rights therein. To sketch out some theoretical directions for placemaking practice, I'll describe the Citizen's Guide to South Sacramento, an outcome of an experimental urban design studio with undergrad students at UC Davis, and that's part of the Sacramento Diocese Project, is an ongoing project that I manage and Anastasia made reference to. The Citizen's Guide documents the spatial practices found in South Sacramento's most racially and ethnically diverse district. It proposes a series of interventions that circumvent the expected use of space and problematize existing planning policies through what I call tactics of urban graft. I'll then conclude by identifying some implications for an emplaced practice that engages the spatial contradictions found in urban places and which creatively explores this relationship between material thinking, location, and human action. In the state of exception, Giorgio Agamben draws from the events shortly after 9/11 and the use of a state of emergency by the Bush administration to authorize the indefinite suspension of non-citizen rights suspected of terrorism. Agamben argues that this state of exception is not necessarily a provisional measure, but an inherent part of government that perpetually transcends the juridical order in the name of the public good. Now, what is at stake, Agamben notes, is this relationship between law and violence as the state determines who gets to live and who gets to die. From this perspective, the truly political is only that actor which is able to sever that relationship between violence on one hand and law on the other. In a similar vein, cultural anthropologist Ewa Ong extends the analysis of exception to encompass the extraordinary departure in policy that can be deployed to include as well as exclude. She applies this definition to analysis of neoliberalism as, in her own words, a technology of sovereignty that differentially regulates populations through market forces and which selectively produces entrepreneurial forms of citizenship in lieu of social rights. Those not subscribing to market-oriented policies are vulnerable to exclusionary practices and thus are not considered full members of a political community in which market forces delineate boundaries of the polity. Low-skilled migrants, undocumented individuals, and refugees with little or no formal education are among the populations whose sovereignty is disarticulated from rights, entitlements, and participation in political life. Now, Ong's analysis of neoliberalism as a technology offers one reading of extra-local forces shaping the everyday practices of marginalized individuals, but I would argue also applies to the places of the excluded. In material terms, exceptions to neoliberalism describes the violence waged against marginalized communities through disinvestment and abandonment. At the scale of the city, governance regimes make decisions that determine which parts of the city flourish and which parts of the city cease to exist when it comes to the allocations of limited resources and the provision of basic services. As some scholars have noted, fiscalization policies and the corporatization of public sector management undermine democratic accountability to the detriment of low-income communities. While the scale and the scope of administrative techniques may differ, the results are the same. Cuts in federal and state funding and the suspension of programs that serve low-income neighborhoods are some of the material effects of urban austerity. For example, the Federal Community Development Block Grant Program was set up over a quarter century ago to support low and moderate income neighborhoods related to affordable housing, infrastructure development, and anti-poverty programs, among other investments. However, in 2011, the program had an annual budget of $2.9 billion. This is down from $4.7 billion in 2005, representing a decrease of over 40% in the last 6 years alone. Similarly, and I think there was a symposium on redevelopment not too long ago, redevelopment agencies, authorized by law since 1945, are also under attack at the state level. And here in California, Governor Brown signed into law a measure that was supported by the state legislature to abolish redevelopment agencies as a short-term measure to close budget gaps at the county and the municipal levels. Now, proponents of the law argue that redevelopment agencies utilize tax revenues that would otherwise support public goods such as schools. Now, granted, redevelopment has a mixed track record, we all know. It was a vehicle for, you know, catastrophic policies that displaced thousands of low-income residents, mostly people of color. However, in recent decades, tax revenues generated from redevelopment areas have been a primary source to fund district-wide planning projects, including historic preservation, parks and street improvements, and transportation enhancements, among other physical improvements to low-income neighborhoods. Another characteristic of urban austerity is the marketization of cities to guarantee the conditions for capital. Managing fiscal debt in times of economic restructuring, reduced taxes, and higher rates of unemployment has forced some cities to borrow money from banks and use municipal bonds to service debt at higher interest rates, which further compounds debt levels. According to a national analysis by the credit bureau Experian, in 2011, the average credit score for U.S. cities was a grade of C, which has had an effect on debt service despite the current low interest rates. Now, this gives an exorbitant amount of power to city bond raters such as Moody's and Standard & Poor's, which determine a city's overall credit worthiness, but ultimately instigate the introduction of market-based reform policies and cuts to government services. However, this is not a new phenomenon resulting from the recent global recession. Rather, it was innovated during the New York City's fiscal crisis in the 70s, leading to what many of us know now as the globalization of the real estate market that continues today. Urban austerity explains not only how neoliberalism continues to shape U.S. cities, but also lives of the most vulnerable. Many sociologists have documented capital accumulation as an outgrowth of political, social, and economic marginalization. In spatial terms, the policing of the poor through punitive planning is one way that neoliberal policies materialize in the built environment and lend an enforcement hand to securitize parts of the city to lower investment risk through the criminalization of low-income neighborhoods. There is increasing evidence from Florida to California how planning practices have been used to enforce policies that curtail the rights for certain populations and in many instances forces individuals to flee in fear. Strategies range from building code violations and banning public assembly to neighborhood preservation ordinances and curfew laws. This is in addition to less obvious forms of exclusion defined by privatization, class and cultural markers of who can occupy public space. The disjuncture between planning and everyday lives of populations is further evident in representations of urban places. Categorization along racial lines and geographic boundaries such as the ghetto, the hood, el barrio, the slum is part of a cultural narrative to subordinate minority groups to the devaluing and disregard of existing places, whose histories mean little other than stories of abandonment and decline, criminality, and the underground economy. Images of places as other are discursively constructed to collectively form a place myth of marginality, whose purpose is to reinforce cultural dominance and reproduce power relations through the use of technology and in the media and within policy and institutional decision making. A recent example is Microsoft's pedestrian routing production. This is a new software app for GPS devices, including cellular phones. According to the patent application submitted by Microsoft, and I quote, "As a pedestrian travels, various difficulties can be encountered, such as traveling through an unsafe neighborhood or being in an open area that is subject to harsh temperatures." Unquote. Now, not without controversy, critics of what has been called the Avoid Ghetto app contend that the use of crime statistics and demographic data simply reinforce stereotypes that link violent crime and race with specific neighborhoods. Proponents counter that it will facilitate pedestrian navigation and that an unsafe neighborhood is an environmental constraint equal to steep hills or hot climates. The Avoid Ghetto app is part of a growing trend that uses technology and social media to bring an environmentally deterministic view of place based on visibility and invisibility, fear, and the illusion of the free market. Now, we know that no single space can represent any one group in its entirety, nor are boundaries as clear and stable as these examples that I just shared with you might suggest. From this perspective, the paradoxical nature of marginality is evident in the tensions between competing representations of place, where marginality is as much about spatial absence as it is about presence. On one hand, many communities remain socially and territorially isolated, where underinvestment is the norm, and other compounding effects include environmental barriers to mobility and lack of access to quality goods, services, and employment in the formal sector. These inequities correlate to neighborhood boundaries, which is frequently coterminous with planning delineations. On the other hand, some places are targeted as part of a planning agenda that views these communities and other vague terrain as sites of gentrification and test beds for the latest sustainability idea. It can be argued that these and other efforts are part of a larger discourse that aims to reimagine neighborhoods in very fundamental ways and not always benefiting the inhabitants of these places. As a field that produces future visions of the city, both creative and symbolic, urbanism is a boundary-making practice that identifies what is common to a public, the form of its visibility, and of its organization. Urbanism serves a purpose in maintaining modes of being and forms of visibility, and like art, can either repress modes of being or reveal new sensory possibilities that instigate novel forms of political subjectivity. Different images of the city and representations of place serve a political purpose by determining what is made visible in the urban landscape and what can be said about it. Multiple and competing knowledge claims exist about the good city and depend on who employs them and for what purpose. For example, a reading of the city from above, as embodied by planners and urban designers, produces representations and future projections of the city that, although always not intentional, conceals the sensibilities of multiple publics and renders invisible the everyday practices and livelihoods of people. Henri Lefebvre called this the illusion of transparency, which masks the reality that spaces of the city are socially produced to serve powerful interest. By contrast, an urbanism from below is the experience of marginalized citizens, their struggles, hopes, and fears, as they seek to order their coexistence in urban places. These are the individuals and groups that do not figure into the images of the city projected by urbanists and whose presence disrupt normative visions of urban life. At stake are the political outcomes emanating from competing images of the city. One response is to conceive an aesthetics of marginality to urban design as an alternative to the dominant image in the city. However, the aestheticizing of urban inhabitants has its risks and can easily render invisible the socio-economic struggles people face and also mass issues of power. Rather, a focus on the uncanny spaces of marginalized places aims to disrupt normative and a priori views of citizen entitlements, to allow for new rights to be imagined, claimed, and enacted. As cultural geographer Jane Jacobs has noted, and I quote here, "If the visual regimes of contemporary cities are thought about as activated spheres of practice, in which various vectors of power and difference are meaningfully negotiated, then the story of aestheticization of the city will unfold in ways that will defy the expected," end quote. The staging of difference, where marginalized groups negotiate a sense of belonging, authorship, and power, points to a supplemental image of and trajectory for the city. Acknowledging the historic and discursive violence towards marginalized places instigates the coming to terms with difference, not as an urban anxiety, but as a form of grounding in place. This raises questions about the way planners and urban designers think about place and the fixity of boundaries between here and there, inside and outside, the visible and the invisible, and what it means to dwell and practice in place. Now, how can practice creatively respond to these extra-local forces that manifest in marginalized places? This is the question I posed to a group of undergrad students in an urban design studio last year. The studio was the first effort of a nascent collaboration with the Sacramento Building Healthy Communities, a community-based planning initiative funded by the California Endowment, and they're funding these efforts throughout the state of California. However, the main goal of the studio wasn't necessarily technical assistance per se, but rather to explore through the design of urban spaces this relationship between everyday spatial appropriations and more formally organized sites and activities. How many of you have been to Sacramento? About half. So South Sac, just to give you a sense, that area shaded in red has a population of about 40,000. Located immediately south of downtown, which is where the Google Market today is. It's one of the most culturally diverse areas of the larger Sacramento region due to its multi-ethnic neighborhoods, comprised of African Americans, Chinese, Hmong, Laotians, Yen, and Vietnamese, among other groups. But South Sacramento is commonly viewed in the region as a marginal place. And this perception has led to underinvestment as compared to other parts of the city. Now, the area faces a number of acute challenges, including dwindling government resources to support redevelopment, and I don't think that's unique, but it's a huge issue in this place. Scarcity of private investment capital, few jobs, and higher poverty rates compared to the surrounding area. Now, despite these circumstances, the de facto strategy to urban regeneration in South Sac has been to do what? Track through the build and development. So, for example, although forecasts are less than optimistic about economic growth in the area and project incremental recovery in 10 years or more, a 2009 Urban Land Institute study envisions growth solely in terms of large-scale development projects and expects interest by developers as, in their own words, a game-changing event in the near term. So there's a hope that the economy will turn around quickly, even though there's an excess supply of developed land that exists in this part of the city. It's also one of the areas that have been hardest hit by foreclosure. But little attention has been given alternatively to small-scale spaces of exchange, both formal and informal, which is an important part of South Sacramento's local economy. By contrast, the ULI study recommends, and this is in their own words, enactment of design guidelines and code enforcement, and beginning a more proactive code enforcement process to reduce developer and investor risk. So the result is a framing of South Sac in terms of, you know, lax enforcement, risk, and abandonment, you know, in some, a marginal place. Now, while specific to South Sac, what I just discussed is indicative, I would argue, of a normative planning practice. This includes a reliance on proscriptive and prescriptive policies based on assumptions about land use and the intended character of urban places. So for those of you that don't know, proscriptive regulation has a long history, including zoning, forbids certain activities and uses for a particular place. This use-based zoning originally aimed to prevent pollution and overcrowding, but is now employed to ban specific groups of people and activities in public space, including day laborers and street vendors, as well as non-conforming uses on residential sites, such as home businesses and house occupancy that exceeds single-family standards. Alternatively, prescriptive techniques dictate which activities are required, where, and the particular form and character of buildings in public space. Prescriptive zoning is exemplified by design guidelines and form-based codes often associated with new urbanism that emphasizes the civic purpose of urban design. However, the privileging of the figural over the temporal and the imposition of a neo-traditional spatial order are not necessarily compatible with hybrid and often ad hoc landscapes that characterize placemaking in many urban neighborhoods. It's the reliance on prescriptive and proscriptive approaches to policy and practice that is fundamentally at odds with the informal city and reveals cultural assumptions about how land is to be used, for whom, and what purpose. If the aim is to make legible the informal city in practice, there's a need to grapple with the often messy conditions found in places such as South Sacramento. In the UC Davis studio, students were asked to test assumptions about land, property, and zoning by beginning with, but expanding upon, the spatial circumstances found on the ground. The purpose was to experiment in placemaking through theoretical interventions that responded to struggles over public space, matters of livelihood, and rights of inhabitation. For the first part of the course, groups of students were divided into teams to conduct oral histories of different cultural groups and were asked to pull together secondary data to begin understanding past and present conditions. They then developed a series of graphics to represent trends, as well as illuminate differences between local narratives, commonly held perceptions, and the socioeconomic data they were pouring over. Parallel to the team activities, individual students were asked to observe and document everyday spaces in South Sacramento that challenges conventional ideas and ideals about land use and zoning and the use of public and private space. This included the use of streets and sidewalks as spaces of economic exchange, as well as the appropriation of strip mall parking lots and private property for social and cultural purposes. One example shown here is the parking lot of an auto parts store that is also location for a recycling center operating out of a ship container and a taco truck that supports these activities. Another example is an urban agriculture field created through an informal arrangement between Hmong gardeners and an adjacent Catholic elementary school that owns the land. And you can see the garden plots in that plan view, the big swath of dark green. The gardeners pay the school for water usage but are not charged for the garden plots themselves. And the way the arrangement is done is that names of individuals are recorded in a handwritten notebook. And if they choose to leave, they basically cross their names off the list, which makes a garden plot available for someone else to use. So for some students, these and other sites will later serve as the basis for specific design interventions. A number of the proposals responded to the material conditions and the ephemeral qualities of spatial appropriation. Others instigated new arrangements between social groups, local nonprofit organizations, as well as government agencies. But overall, the proposals sought to create spaces between formal and informal structures, public and private land, and among the different groups that call self-sustainability. One example shown here, it's a little washed out, is a cultural facility that provides a location for Hmong language classes, New Year's celebration, Hmong New Year is a pretty big event annually, and a weekend farmers market, as well as a hall for both community and private events. And the facility shown in that sort of that dark brown is strategically positioned next to the agricultural fields on the right, and makes a physical connection to a collection of buildings across the street that house a number of Hmong-serving NGOs that have been there for like 20 to 40 years. In another project, a portion of an existing strip mall parking lot is appropriated for a Pan-Asian night market that creates a space for street vendors. Architectural elements and lighting features are used to break down the scale of a large supermarket to the left of that section, which you can't see, but also creates a very visible landmark in a automobile-dominated landscape. To address housing issues, another student proposed adaptive housing as a form of incremental construction based on available funds and functional needs of individual households. He proposed using ship containers and modifying them as modular units that could expand or contract to accommodate a range of social and cultural conditions, including extended families, home businesses, and outdoor spaces for group gatherings. In this last example, a student proposed modification of a parking lot to serve as a shared plaza and parking space. To preserve a range of informal activities, the parking lot remains, as a plan on the right-hand side. The diagram on the left shows the existing pattern preserved on the site. So the parking lot remains, but raised parking medians are incorporated to accommodate vending and socializing. In addition, there's a covered outdoor area, which you can't see in the building here. It's created as a flexible space between existing businesses that can be used for community events, quinceañeras, and a daily market. So these and other student proposals are part of the Citizens Guide, South SAC, and will be given to local organizations to stimulate dialogue about future strategies that build on everyday placemaking practices. And I'm having discussions right now, ongoing with a number of community organizations, to see how the ideas expressed in the Citizens Guide can be used to assess existing policies, as sort of planning as a form of critique, and inform ongoing planning initiatives that are taking place currently. So imagining negotiative spaces between public and private realms, structured and unstructured activities, challenges existing binaries between the formal and the informal. Much like a bud or a shoot that grafts onto a host tree, informal activities can combine with formal uses in novel ways to create synergies between various scales of production and activate sites during different times of the day and the evening. Attaching and bridging, rooting and implanting, are words for a vocabulary space that describe what I'm calling these tactics of urban graft. The proposal for a night market that introduces a new use to an existing strip mall, or adaptive housing that responds to issues of livelihood, are some of the examples I just mentioned. These hybrid landscapes join disparate uses, breathe life into existing spaces, and create new sites where none existed before. The manner in which spaces are re-territorialized and repurposed offer a different logic of urban regeneration that does not fit easily into existing discourses of urbanism. Rather, they exemplify a form of place-based resiliency and how the built environment can be staged, adapted, and modified to incorporate localized social processes. Visualizing latent capacities through spatial imaginations of place can also instigate critiques of existing policies and regulations. Oppositional tactics to the present order of things move beyond the cognitive and physical constraints of existing building codes, policies, and zoning regulations. This form of retrograde planning considers how struggles over space, the necessities of life, and citizenship claims begin in a location other than the present. Engaging these uncanny spaces and inhabiting the margins of practice also destabilizes the relationship between subject and object, planner and client. However, operating the symbolic or representation realm is not enough. An embodied practice needs to instigate different ways of doing and making and involves the creative and collaborative acts of practitioners and place dwellers alike. A challenging but important task for the planning and urban design profession is to reveal knowledge and link, bridge, and mobilize multiple imaginations to create a place for transformative politics. The prospects for an engaged citizenry rest on place as a right of urban inhabitation because it is through placemaking that awareness, understandings, and meanings begin to take shape. Moreover, place ultimately reflects and is the outcome of various negotiations. By belonging to a community and participating in local decisions and navigating geometries of power. Although modest in scope, experiments in placemaking can reimagine cities in profound ways and raise a number of questions for practice. For example, how can an in-place practice foster greater social awareness? What are the significant outcomes of placemaking for citizens? And how do placemaking practices build the capacity of social groups to create political change? As evidenced by these questions, planning in the margin requires negotiating boundaries of visibility and invisibility, space and place, politics and the law. However, an in-place practice also sheds light on what has remained hidden, namely the perpetuation of social inequality and the avoidance of the most marginalized citizens and places. A critical question concerning the informal city is not how it can be planned or designed to fit with the current norms of practice, but rather how the illusion of urban order has been maintained while perpetuating a system that benefits particular interests, including the planning profession. Imaginaries of place are more than the appearance of space, as they encourage creative acts which open up possibilities for new subjectivities. This can help sever the relationship between the discursive violence enacted on marginalized places and punitive policies and laws that target the most vulnerable in our cities. Whether design imaginations can foster social, spatial, and political capacity, or produce new forms of dominance, is an open question and will depend on particular times and places. In conclusion, to dream the city anew will require adopting a supplemental set of values, norms, and expectations about urban life, and making political choices that fly in the face of disciplinary affinities, class affiliations, and cultural attachments. If the right to the city, as David Harvey notes, is a right to change ourselves by changing the city more after our heart's desire, then it follows that the image of the city serves a purpose to win over the hearts and minds of urban citizens. Imagining the city within the liminal zone of marginality is an ethical choice, but one that has implications for the design of cities and the role of planning and facilitating human action. Thank you.
Planning agencies and so forth are in themselves independent actors in perpetuating inequality. One, two, one, three, they're just merely apparatus of a larger superstructure of other forces, wider forces. And second one is that, although I understand the role of imagination as leading to maybe access, solutions, and so forth, and but my question is, how do we know whether those things have material effectiveness? So it's one thing to have a creative mind, create space to think alternatively, but how do we as planners evaluate whether those things are just in the realm of imagination and versus realm of action, effective action?
Well, I think the latter question first. That is fundamentally what planners do. It's not imaginations for just the excluded. I mean, planning, plans, are all about social imaginations about the future of what a particular city or space is going to look like. Okay? So, in that case, we are in the business, if you will, of imagining different realities than the present conditions.
And that's where apparatus is superstructure.
What's that?
Unless we're an apparatus.
Well, I think that doesn't make a difference whether you're an apparatus of superstructure or whether you're an independent actor. We're still engaged in the same type of practice. So the question is, being raised as one of reflexivity and considering which imaginations or whose interests is my particular imagination I'm helping put together benefit, right? And to what extent? Which I guess relates to your first question, right?
Because you can't have that independence without plans. The first question is whether the plan is that.
So, you know, I actually, in some other work that I'm doing right now, this idea of independence or independent actors or not, I think, is perhaps a false binary. Right? It puts it either or, and I think it depends on the circumstance in which we are often independent actors at one level of placemaking, but we are part of a system at another scale of placemaking. So I think it really depends on which level, place is enacted, whether it's the scale of the city, the region, or a national neighborhood. That's not to suggest necessarily the sort of hierarchical notion that the broader you get, the more you're embedded in a superstructure. But in terms of reinforcing sort of dominance as an individual actor, we may not necessarily do it when we're working in the realm of planning in terms of communities or just a city, but it's also in more of the sort of embodied forms of practice when we run a meeting, right? How we engage others that have different assumptions that are based on culture, etc. So in those instances, I think it's very acute where we are acting as an individual actor, and there's a possibility either for dominance or for opening up new spaces of dialogue. The book that we just completed is really trying to get to that the latter notion of the practitioner as an individual agent and the choices we make in multiple settings.
I enjoyed it a lot, and I told you. I was thinking, I've got a more mundane, but a more building on. I think in your paper and what you have tried to address what will always be this bigger question of how important is this question of placemaking, how relevant it is, how big a difference will it make within the larger structures. And you sort of do that in the paper and here. So that's the critique from the left, and it has to be addressed. And it's a tricky one, but I do believe in the agency of planning, but I think it's bounded and it's limited, but there is. I think there is a critique from the right, which we don't think about that much, which is the problem of collective action and contested interests, even when we are talking about marginalized sections. So, for example, the proposals we have, you know, there's the Hmong gardens, community gardens for the Hmong community. There's the Pan-Asian market. There's the Latino vendors in the, I think you in the paper you specifically say Latino. So, but how do we actually bring people together through design, which, you know, the logic of collective action?
So I said, yes, that is, I think we have to understand and be able to address that even better. That we can do that through design, and that, and I think the trick is along the lines that you, the spirit of the class, which is observing how, and the everyday urbanism tenet, that we, there are lessons to be learned, because if you look at communities, they do come together. And we can perhaps learn from them. But I think that is a critique, that that part is difficult, is also something we have to seriously address.
Right. And yeah, I agree. I mean, I just a, another example that's not in South Sac, but one that I've been looking at in San Diego, is the market at Village Creek, and how that was, that part of Southeast San Diego is known as the Four Corners of Death, because there's a, you know, highly contested sort of, you know, drug zone, and the a lot of the community members got together. It was instigated by Jacobs Foundation, but once they got together, they realized that they had a lot in common, and they were really intentional about really creating a different imagination for that, that the Four Corners of Death. And now it's a, you know, a center, a village center that has mixed-use development, and there's plans for the environmental restoration of Local Creek. They were the first community development IPO in the country, because the residents, after coming together, really wanted to, you know, had a stake in that effort, and they worked with a lawyer for a number of years, and actually had to change California state law around IPOs in order so that they could be investors with, you know, sums of money between $500 and $600. So, you know, I think it's very dangerous to conflate, you know, these, you know, small examples here and there with, you know, changing the world. But, you know, I don't subscribe to this notion that the world's going to change in that very dramatic way. It's about, you know, how do we, you know, if we look at the polity as arena of policy makings and even social movements that are, their goal is to change the polity, and that includes regulation. That happens at different scales of action and decision making. And so whether it's changing a land use ordinance to allow for a business to flourish, or changing state law to, you know, own the development, I see them as equal. And that's why this notion of place, to me, I want to emphasize, although I'm using examples of my own work in local neighborhoods, place is not scale dependent. What we need more of, I think, is the type of research that, and there is, there's a lot of work on regional equity now, like colleagues of mine that are doing that as well, to begin to put all of these together and see that there is something bigger than just sort of one-off case studies. And there's as much failure as there is success, but that's no different in a low-income community as it is working with the Chamber of Commerce. Right?
Can I hit my follow-up question? So, another thing. So you criticize market-based urbanism. And two things struck me. One, from the presentation, and one with the Market Creek Plaza. I think of Market Creek Plaza as a market-based method. I mean, it is community shares, but it is very different from Dudley Street neighborhood doing the community land trust. So this is sort of a conservative foundation doing a market. So I think there is some potential there. Right. Second, I think you criticize redevelopment I'm ambivalent about it, but I think redevelopment is based on the idea that you will have tax increments that will pay for it. And in that sense, the only way redevelopment that can work is if you have massive and grander, these large and big projects that you Urban Land Institute was. And that's the only way the redevelopment model can work. So I'm sort of, and this is nitpicking in your detail, yes. But while suggesting that maybe there is opportunity within market-based methods like the market free, and then redevelopment, and sort of given that it is more likely than not to result in this big displacement-based development, maybe we should celebrate the demise of CRAs.
There's two issues there. One is this market-based economy and its role. And I guess I subscribe to, yes, we operate in a capitalist system in terms of planning. But I look at it from more of, Gibson Graham's notion of community economies, where people have a right to their labor and gain surpluses from that, but also to pour that back into the community. So it's a very different notion, I think, of the market than what we are familiar with or what planning operates within. In terms of redevelopment, we had this discussion last night that redevelopment became this very, it's so far from its original intentions, and that who's using redevelopment funds now? Has nothing to do with its original purpose of looking at certain parts of the city, but now it's just a way to get more money to fuel more and more development. So it got, in a sense, too big. Now, change is good, and a lot of interesting ideas are being thrown around now about what's next. I guess in this particular case of South Sacramento, there are a lot of strip malls that are popping up new that the city is not even involved with. You have investors from Taiwan who put their money in San Jose, saturated that market, now they're moving to Sacramento. So when I go up and down, say, Stockton Boulevard, all the area codes are from places like San Jose. So in that case, the market, I don't have a problem with the market. I think where I have a problem with redevelopment is how it introduced something large, the scale of it large, that begins to shift a lot of energy. And there's a certain aspect of that, of sort of homogenization, based on the way those projects are funded, they have to look and feel a certain way, which is not necessarily representative of the types of norms, local norms and cultural practices of a lot of those communities. So it's really bringing in that sort of middle class market finance mentality that I'm reacting against, not necessarily development per se.
To express this question, institutionally, where do you see, how do you instigate change for things that we all want to see? Yes, I'm saying this kind of just completed with a student of mine, the study of plants, how urban design plants are made in the largest cities. And it is appalling in terms of almost no participation. There is the most kind of public hearings that people have 2.5 minutes to express their opinions. A lot relying on private consultants. You see all these keywords, sustainability, and which are pretty hollow, they mean nothing. And so, as I think you very effectively showed, that in a lot of these neighborhoods like South Sac, they just don't even register, they're completely invisible. So where would you see, if it is not the planning department, where would change, is it grassroots groups, is it non-profits, what are the institutions that could bring about the change that we all want? What are your thoughts about that? I know I'm asking that million-dollar question.
I could answer that question.
But
win a Nobel Prize or something.
Yeah, right, I know.
Yeah, well,
I don't have an answer myself.
Yeah, you know.
I'm troubled. That's why I'm asking this.
I guess I'm sort of. Maybe I'm revealing sort of my sort of post-structural tendencies here, but I don't think there is an answer, nor should there be, because it really, I mean, if one takes to heart this notion of place and embodiment and placement, the responses are very context-specific. So the danger, I think, that begins at school, you know, planning design schools and then ends up in public agencies, is that we profess, you know, universal answers to particular problems. And I think what we need to begin to shift, at least in education, thinking about how we are training future practitioners as choreographers, as curators. Granted, there are technical skills that everyone needs to know, but it's how do we equip practitioners with situational toolkit, if you will. And so the arrangement of different actors, grassroots, public agencies, and individual market, you know, we all know that there has been a trend of looking at different forms of governance networks that involve elements of those different sectors. And there's critiques, you know, on the right as well as the left of different governance structures. You know, rather than thinking about there is only a particular sector in which planning gets situated or a type of organization, it's really thinking about how one could constantly adapt and grow in ways that allow for connections to be made to, I mean, being very abstract here, but I have a hard time sort of speaking in sort of specific, you know, unless we talk about specific, you know, context and place. A lot of this is historicized as well, in terms of when is there an opportunity to create change in institution, right? So there are opportunities to do that. I mean, framing of place in terms of rights and what a community can become is part of the rhetorical strategy to change institutions and individuals. But there are others that have to do with, comes down to just the resources, or, you know, or fighting when there's opportunity to really drive a wedge in some of the existing structures in a city or municipality. So, a very vague answer to you.
Yeah, well, yeah,
broad question.
Well, two things. First, this is a comment. I should say, I was born in Sacramento, raised in Oak Park. And so, and I still have connection. Oak Park is the traditional African American town part of South Sacramento. And, you know, I spent a good part of my life experiencing what it means to live in such a neighborhood. And that's just sort of a background of my sense of that area. But I have a broader question which brings us back to planning. In much of the sort of cultural studies literature that's related to cities, and thinking about strategies of planning, that literature privileges place over the concept of access. You know, you do not see a large, robust literature in terms of cultural critiques about access. But if you look at what divides marginalized, disadvantaged communities from other ones, not just place of power, but people's ability to access economic opportunities, access cultural facilities, access other sorts of resources. And so there is...
They're related.
Yeah, they're related. But so my question is, but why do we, at least in the literature, there is a privilege of discussion about place, but far less thinking about the access issue?
and cultural studies.
Yeah,
around
yeah, yeah. In the cultural studies. Well, I don't believe in the value of cultural studies because I think we have to think and have imagination beyond what currently exists. So I think there's a problem with that.
But I would say the conventional literature's emphasis is away from place. And what Michael is sort
that's
of...
That's true.
I think he's sort of suggesting that we don't talk about place enough in most of the planning literature.
In the traditional planning. And maybe that's even a broader critique, why this divide in sort of the paradigms that we use. One, explicitly addressing access.
And
one focusing on place.
And I think the divide is very artificial because, I mean, if you think about,
I agree with you,
the spatial justice that Ed is talking about, it is very much the intermarriage of access and space. I mean, we're talking among ourselves, but that's good because it can generate. can we have, let's have one question from you guys.
This is good, yeah. But let's start, I want to, this is a very important topic to come back to.
Yeah. I didn't
let you respond. No, I mean, I want to get more people involved in the conversation, but I think we can come back to this one as this sort of, in a sense more, I would say, a Rawlsian notion on one hand about the role of planning and the redistribution of resources, and on the other, a more, phenomenological aspect of embodiment that I think draws about. It's not either or, but both. But there is a privilege on both. And Clark, actually, I didn't talk about it here, but the paper mentioned briefly that there is a still perception of Oak Park being African American.
It's not enough.
But it's actually African Americans are now the minority. But this perception is not just about cultural heritage. It's a racialized space that gets reinforced constantly, and the residents are doing acts of self-policing because they associate it with black violence. It's just this interesting phenomena of, again, the perception of place, even among residents, when the actual demographics tell us most otherwise. There's a question.
Thank you very much. And you have had spoken a little bit about new social media and mobile apps and the Avoid Ghetto app and how that has a tendency to stigmatize spaces. And I was wondering if you had ever encountered any situations where social media had actually empowered spaces and allowed residents to define what the places are for themselves and connect to each other. And there's one example that sticks out in my mind that I'm familiar with out of the USC Annenberg School of Communication. There's a professor there, Francois Barr, who's working on a project on social media apps as a place-making storytelling device. And so very simple SMS-based app where any resident or person can take a picture and post a comment, and then it gets uploaded onto a database on a website that's available to everyone. And so I wonder if social media and the technology, if it is necessarily something that will divide people and draw out differences, or if it has an ability to pull people together based on places, or if you're skeptical of that.
Well, the short answer is both. I mean, whether we call it social media or some other term, is technology, right?
Sure.
And so if we look at technology historically as a tool, it can be used for radically different purposes. It depends on whose hands the technology is and for what purpose. So I was suggesting in my critique here that it can't be used as a form of awareness and placement, sure, because there's a whole literature on PPGIS that talks about that. Some work I was doing in Philadelphia a number of years ago was, working with residents to map parks, open space, and trees, and to begin to develop, I guess it wasn't called that back then, but now it's called an HIA, Health Impact Assessment. Mm-hmm. So these are ways that technologies can be incorporated as a form of citizen science or citizen planning.
Sure.
So I'm all for that. I mean, another example is, I don't know if it's even popular anymore, is the use of Yellow Arrow, where
people, you take a sticker and it has a text number on there. So you put the yellow sticker wherever you want, and you can tell a story about the place. So if someone sees the sticker, sure, they just punch it and get the text, and they learn about that place. Mm-hmm. And I think it was either in Amsterdam that was used as a base to talk, a vehicle planning to talk about their community,
sure,
and became a whole planning exercise unto itself. So I think I'm really just reacting lately to things like the Ghetto app, or there are a number, I can't remember, there's somebody out there now, that when you go to a location and you know, this sort of hardest place marketing is about the best and the worst neighborhoods now. So it has the same purpose, I think, as the Ghetto app does.
Right.
It kind of, you know, it's just a discursive way to, in a sense, influence people's behavior before they even make decisions of whether to actually experience the place themselves.
Right.
So it's just, I think it's more of a, we're at the beginning of this, and I think it's, you know, it's going to get, I teach geography as well, and we had a session on GIS, cartography and visualization, this week, and we were talking about the map as a representation, and how the map viewer could look at it and make an assessment and saw that as reality. But over, you know, with technology, more and more, the map has really closed the distance between us and that artifact. We are the maps now. So with GPS devices and the tracking of our bodies in space, you know, there are implications for planning, some of which we're talking a little bit at lunch today. So I think this is the right area that really needs a lot of good minds around thinking through this problematic, because it ultimately comes down to issues of one's rights,
sure,
and issues of public and private. And are we not in the business in terms of thinking about issues of public and private planning?
Well, thank you.